the talk, because there are particular interests and motivations behind the pictures that I'd want to kind of share and talk about, really. So it would be a question of walking around the exhibition. So if you're all happy to do that, that's the form it will take. And then I'll do questions at the end, if that's okay, because I've got all this chronology in my head, and if I start answering questions, I'll get lost. So I'm a man of a certain age now, so I need to keep it all quite focused. The exhibition itself actually ignores the chronology that the work was made in very deliberately. It's sort of mixed up because Anne and I were quite interested in making some sort of visual associations between different periods of work and from different periods of time. But I think for the purpose of this, it's useful to kind of stick to the chronology. So we'll be kind of whizzing backwards and forwards a little bit around the exhibition. But hopefully it'll all make sense. So I grew up in Bradford, this is my hometown, and I don't know how many of you are actually from Bradford, but I grew up on the Buttershaw estate, the notorious, in inverted commas, Buttershaw estate, because as a lot of you will know who are from here, it's got lots of negative associations. I was born in a house on Brafferton Arbour. One of my neighbours was Andrea Dunbar, who wrote the stage play The Arbour, which then became the film Rita Sue and Bob Two, that was filmed actually on the Arbour. And I have real problems with that film, and I have problems with the representations of working class people. And that's kind of what I want to start talking about, really. Because the perception of residents of Buttershaw that was created by the making of that film was kind of wholly inaccurate, really, because there was then, and I'm sure there are still now, lots of really decent, honest, you know, working families who try and do the right thing by their kids and try and make ends meet. And, you know, my family was definitely in that category. My mum virtually brought us up single-handedly, and she kept us out of trouble. So the trouble with the media and that kind of film and the kinds of social documentary photography that I want to start talking about very rarely represents that kind of person, that kind of working person. It tends to dwell on negative aspects of life. So I'll come back to that later. So my route into photography really came via admiration and music. Okay, admiration was for my best friend, who still is one of my best friends, a guy called Andy Simpson. And he was, you know, the cool kid on the block. He was the kid that everybody wanted to be when you were a teenager. And Andy had a camera. And so, you know, I had to have a camera as well in order to be cool. So that was my first contact, really, with photography. But music has always been really important in my life as well. And also a particular kind of music, mainly soul music, and latterly, you know, I've grown into liking jazz and things, but the period of time I'm talking about is early 70s, so soul music, particularly southern soul music, music coming out of the southern states of America. And it had a particular resonance for me and for my friends because, you know, unlike the conventional classic 3-minute pop tune, the kinds of things that were coming out of Tamla Motown that were preoccupied with kind of love and romance, the sort of music that was coming out of the southern states of America, the musicians were talking about their everyday social experience, okay? And that was generally, you know, an experience of poverty, neglect, lack of opportunity. And I just want to play you two little pieces of music to give you a sense of what I'm talking about, but just to ask you to urge you to listen to the lyrics a little bit. Oh, I need my glasses.
Told you I was a man of a certain age. found your jacket.
It's probably not mine. Staple Singers, and it's a song called When Will We Be Paid for the Work We've Done? And the previous song was by Martha Reeves called Dead End. And what you might get a sense of there is how these musicians are articulating their kind of social reality, really. And it's something that really struck a chord with me, and I would argue all of my friends as well who were shared the same obsession with music. Because if you took race out of that question and replaced it with class, there's an awful lot of identification that we could make with some of those expressions in those songs. And for me, it was really an education, because it's via that music that I became socially and politically aware, I suppose. And so you've got this combination of a growing awareness via music of, you know, social, political arguments, a recognition of that in my own life and my own experience, and this growing fascination with photography that, you know, started off, you know, as a kind of piece of jewellery, but actually turned into what's becoming a sort of life obsession, really. And those two things came together at Bradford Central Library, the same library that's now here, bizarrely, but used to be up by the National Media Museum, because I'd started to go in there and look at their photography collection. And I came across this book. This is the second edition of the same book, but it's by a photographer who photographed the civil rights movement, some of the protests and some of the responses from the police to people who were involved in the civil rights movement. And it was the first time, really, where I saw this kind of connection between, you know, the kind of black politics, social injustice, and photography. And it was a time when I really thought, you know, photography is actually capable of doing this, of saying things. It's possible to, you know, maybe change the way people think about things via the medium of photography. Thank you very much.
It's a very special, it rare like music.
Real life music?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
So I spent a lot of time revisiting the photography collection in the library, and I didn't really know at that time the kinds of photographic expressions that I would later come to identify as being documentary. So, you know, I'd look at all the books, but I definitely gravitated towards a particular kind of photography that, of course, I now know as being documentary. And I came across this book, which is the book from the famous exhibition Family of Man at the Museum of Modern Art in New York. I don't know if there's anybody here from the library.
Anyone here from the library or Bradford Council? Could you just leave for a minute, please?
Because I never took this book back. I took it out in May 1977. I don't know what the fine would be on that now.
Still turn a profit.
So that was really my into photography, and I became more and more obsessed by it, as you do, and that eventually led me to consider studying photography seriously. And I went to study at Newport on the documentary photography course there. I studied with Tim Smith, who's in my year over there. And I just cannot tell you what an experience that was, because, you know, to be in a room where people share the same kind of passion and enthusiasm for the thing that you had quietly and privately gone with the, you know, the last year or so, was just like life-affirming, you know. You weren't crazy, you weren't mad. Other people sort of shared that sort of, you know, desire to work with photography in that way. But it was also important for me personally, because it was, for me, one of the first times where I started to really meet people from different social backgrounds. That was the great thing about the course, and still is, that, you know, the intake of students is very, very diverse. So you've got lots of different life experiences. And so it really enhanced my life, and, you know, it challenged some of my prejudices that I had about people from particular backgrounds. So it was an interesting process. What I realised quite early on through studying on the course was, this is to go back to the thing I started at the beginning, is the representation of working people. I realised that at this time there was a real unhealthy, obsession in photography, in documentary photography particularly, with working class people. And you can see that if you look through some of the publications at the time. This is British Images 1 and 2, which were published by the Arts Council in the mid-70s. And they're sort of collections of what was considered to be important photographic works of the time. And it's hard for you to see at the back, but generally it's this kind of, you know, it's, don't get me wrong, it's all well-intended photography. You know, I don't think the photographers are deliberately trying to paint people in a bad light, but it is preoccupied with a particular aspect of working life. It's also a particular representation of the North as well, which is interesting. You know, this kind of bleak, sort of, you know, dark, foreboding place. And it was very preeminent at that time in photography. That also manifests itself regularly in mainstream media. You know, the colour supplements like The Observer and The Sunday Times. Again, all well-intended, all quite worthy, but this particular downbeat, negative portrayal of working life. And particularly striking, I think, when I saw Don McCullin's photographic coverage of Bradford. I don't know how many of you have seen this.
Yeah. shown again recently at the Video Museum.
Okay,
a couple of years ago.
So this really struck home for me, you know, and it made me start to really think about how you can represent people, and how actually that kind of, you know, to be a photographer, it's a very powerful position, because, you know, you can influence the way people think about things. And I think as a photographer, particularly a documentary photographer, you need to be really mindful of that. And so, you know, I've always tried my best to portray people who I have a common experience with, but to try and portray them in a way that doesn't victimize them and doesn't stigmatize them in a particular way. You know, I think it's a very complicated existence. And I've tried, through all the work I've done, to try and look at some of those kind of complicated, you know, reasons for why people are the way they are and reasons for why people behave in the way that they do. So I was quite determined early on to try and stay away from that kind of picture making. And I remember one lecture that we had in Newport from a man called Ian Walker, who just recently retired. And he showed us the work of August Sander. I don't know how many of you are familiar with August Sander, but he was a very, very important German photographer who set himself a personal goal of photographing every single type of person in Germany. And, you know, this is like volume one of 12 volumes. It's a huge thing, huge piece of work. Most of it was destroyed, interestingly, by the Nazis, because they considered it to be subversive. Anyway, we had this lecture, and I saw work like this, where working people, for the first time in my experience, were being photographed with some sense of pride and dignity. You know, they weren't being turned into... Well, they weren't being stigmatized in any particular way. And this particular picture here had a particular resonance for me, because prior to going to college, I worked on building sites all my life, and in fact worked in Germany on building sites for about 4 years. And so, you know, not that long before I went to college, I'd been working with people who actually looked like this. So, you know, I recognized the tools, I recognized the method of building. And it really struck a chord with me that's the kind of thing that I would strive to do, is to try and represent people honestly. And that's the result of that experience, really. These were, I mean, all of the works that are in the exhibition come from much larger pieces. So this is a small collection of photographs that I made of working people in Newport. You know, I've always been really good at stealing other people's ideas. But I think that's how you learn, actually. You know, is you try and emulate something, and eventually something of your own comes out, really. So I very unashamedly would go and try and make pictures similar to the things I'd seen of August Sander. So this was quite important to me. These were pictures I made before I went to college, so this is a period where, you know, I'm making those visits to the Bradford Library and stealing their books. And this particular picture is interesting, and we've particularly placed it here because it's the view that you have out of that window. I don't know if anybody recognised that. So that's how it used to look. Okay, so we're going to move on, and we're going to go over here. So if you want to follow me, take my coffee. Thank you. So this is from a piece of work I made when I was a student at Newport. I was there from 82 to 84. And this was a council estate in the Rhondda Valley called Penrhys. And the reason why I went there was because it just reminded me so much of Buttershaw. You know, it's the highest council estate in Wales. It's stuck right on the top of a mountain, in the way that Buttershaw is. You know, those of you from Bradford will know that, right on the top of near Queensbury. And, you know, there was lots of similar sort of social economic problems there as well. So I wanted to go there because it reminded me a little bit of here. And what I don't have in the exhibition are these kinds of pictures, which are the things that I started to make, which would conform, you know, to some of that kind of documentary photography that was very prevalent at the time. You know, it was me trying to work in a sort of immersive way, you know, trying to get involved in people's lives, spend long periods of time with them in order to sort of photograph them, hopefully with some sense of authority and intimacy. But I chose not to show this work anymore for some of the reasons that I talked about at the beginning. And what this work is actually, it was originally just intended to be an introduction to the people who lived on the estate. I ran a thing that I called a free photographic studio. I set a white backdrop up in the local shopping centre, and I fly posted all around the estate saying that I'd be in that space at particular days over a 2-week period, and I'd photograph people for free. So people turned up. I actually had queues of people waiting for me when I arrived in the morning. It was fantastic. And the idea was I'd photograph people, and then I'd go back to college, I'd make prints, I'd come back, and I'd deliver the prints to the people, get to know them a little bit. You know, photography is very manipulative in that way. And also, you know, get to a point where they could know who I was and why I was wandering around with the camera. But I think what I've realised over the years is that actually this stuff, which I thought was the project, actually doesn't really hold any interest for me anymore. But I'm really still drawn to these. And I'm drawn to them because it's just straight representation of who these people were at this particular point in their lives. And the fact that they don't have any context, you know, like walls covered with mildew or, you know, floors with no carpets on, means that we can't project our kind of prejudices onto the photographs. So in that sense, they're in a kind of neutral space. So all you really have to deal with are the individuals. And I still like that. I think that still has an interesting possibility. Okay, we're going over there now. So, I can you still hear me? I mean, I think probably like most photographers will tell you that actually what, and especially photographers who are, you know, towards the middle or end of their kind of careers will tell you that actually what they've recognised is that they've been, although they might have been photographing different people in different situations, really what they're photographing is their own, their selves and their own experiences, their own biographies. And that manifests itself in different ways. And that's certainly true of me, because, you know, it wasn't sort of premeditated necessarily in that way, but, you know, the fact that I would spend my early life at college photographing on an estate similar to the one I grew up in, photographing in, you know, heavy industrial environments like coal mines and steel mills, I was doing that because there were places that I actually felt comfortable in. You know, as I said, I worked on building sites from leaving school until going to college. So I grew up in a very masculine working environment, and I felt comfortable in those spaces. I felt that I, you know, could identify with the people, I could relate to them, and I think they could relate to me. So it made the process of photography much easier. And so, you know, this would be something that I would have done in coal mines. I did the things in steel mills which are not in the exhibition. So that would be the kind of rationale behind that. And we're going to go in this corner now. Squeeze a bit closer because I've actually got quite a small photograph to show you. So really up to this point, the work that I had done, I'd say would conform to that kind of, you know, humanistic school of photography. You know, it was about the photographer being this sort of supposedly objective observer. You know, the role of the photographer is to photograph honestly what is in front of the camera, without any mediation or kind of intervention of any sorts, you know, fly on the wall documentary. Slightly old fashioned now, that idea. I think, you know, that particular bubble has probably burst. And it burst for me at the making of this picture. This is made on the Penrhys estate where I made the portraits that I showed you. It's a dance class in the community hall there. And it was a Wednesday afternoon. I know that because I went to Newport, so everything I did has got a date and a, you know, caption on it, so I can be quite precise about that. It was a Wednesday afternoon. I could probably even tell you the time. And I photographed and I made this picture at the same time. Can you all see this? I'll pass it round, or I'll blue tack it up on the wall and you can look at it later. But when you get to look at the picture, what you'll realise is that this couple in the photograph is the same couple that's in this picture here. And I remember processing the film and sitting down for a crit with my contact sheets with Daniel Meadows and Martin Parr. It was a quiet day, so there was two members of staff available. And it was a day I will never forget because it was a real turning point for me in photography. And I put this contact sheet down and it was like I'd thrown a hand grenade into the room. This sort of argument erupted around my pictures. And Daniel was in favour of this photograph here that's in my hand because it had some of those kind of classical elements of, you know, social documentary photography. It was a decisive moment. You know, it had some kind of visual juxtaposition, you know, the way that the curtains are embracing in the same way that the couple are embracing as they dance. So his enthusiasm was for this picture. But Martin's enthusiasm was for this photograph on the wall. And he justified it in a very interesting way that really made me think about what photography is, but probably more importantly, what photography can do. And what he said about this picture was that you can only have the experience that you're having looking at this photograph because it's a photographic representation of an event that doesn't look like this in reality. Okay? So the way that this photograph looks, it's made on film, okay, it's pre-digital. It looks like this because the film is incapable of dealing with the wide contrast range. The shaft of sunlight that's coming through the window behind me, catching on this man wearing the white suit, completely washes him out. Okay, when I made the picture, I was not aware of that, because, you know, it's about the intolerance of the film to deal with that. It was only evident on the contact sheet, really. And it was quite a moment for me, you know, this idea that photography in some way could transform something, it could alter a reality. It didn't have to be objective and observed. It could actually be quite subjective and opinionated. And it changed me because, you know, up to this point, I'm looking at all those traditional, you know, magnum documentary photographers. And at this point, and through the conversation with Martin, I was encouraged to look at people like Gary Winogrand, Lee Friedlander, people who are actually using the medium of photography as a kind of visual expression, not just to record something. So that was a turning point for me in my thinking. In the exhibition, it actually juxtaposes quite interesting with this picture, which is pre-college. It's made in Germany, when I was living in Germany in 1979. But we just thought they sat quite nicely together. So, don't have to go too far now, we're here. So this is after I'd left college, just left college, and I was lucky to be commissioned by a photo gallery in Cardiff, who had just started a series of commissions to invite photographers to photograph in the South Wales valleys and to photograph aspects of life that they were thought was interesting and pertinent. And I chose to photograph the introduction of new technology into the valleys. It was particularly interesting sociologically because, you know, as you're all aware, the region's got all those historical associations with heavy industry, coal mining, steel production. All of that clearly has gone into decline. The response, in order to deal with the subsequent unemployment problem, was to attract new businesses to the region through, you know, tax breaks and various other business incentives. And the businesses that were coming were the light technological industries. So industries that were involved in the making of computer components, for example. So that was my proposal, was to look at this shift industrially, but also to look at the geographical and social impact of the introduction of those industries. Again, it's biographical because, you know, I had a sense of what it was like to work in these places because my mum works at Thorn Electrical, used to be called Baird's, up near Ingleby Road. And she used to make TV components. And she had a certain number that she had to make in a day. And if she didn't meet her quota, she used to bring them home and, you know, and work on them at home. So I was really conscious of what the working environment was like and the kinds of pressures that were there. But also, because I've had this sort of Damascus moment around photography, you know, and realised that there's other kinds of photography out there, I started to look at Gary Winogrand and Friedlander, as I said to you earlier. I'm just going to leave that there. A particular work of Lee Friedlander's called Cray, where he photographed in an electrical factory. And his photographs are highly subjective, you know, very, very harsh, very direct, very opinionated. But I also started looking at quite a lot of landscape photography as well. And particularly the school of the new topographics photography, and a guy called Lewis Boltz. Now, the new topographics, there was, you know, it's a movement. There was five, possibly eight photographers all involved in this. And they were all making new interpretations, photographic interpretations of what constituted the American landscape. You know, they were rejecting those kind of, you know, heroic, idealized representations that we would have seen from people like Ansel Adams, you know, those sort of glorifications of the kind of majesty and beauty of the American natural landscape. These guys were much more interested in the kind of prosaic, you know, normal, everyday American landscape. And in the case of Lewis Boltz, you know, he would photograph all these new sort of tin shed, you know, estates that were being developed. In this case, around California. So those are my background interests that inform some of this work. So the first section of the work intended to look at the geographical changes that were happening in the valleys as a result of these new factories. And places like this, that had formerly been the site of coal mines, were being, you know, leveled and prepared for the siting of these tin sheds. And so, you know, the fabric of the landscape was changing. And again, it's a small edit. There's many more pictures in this first section. The middle section here was really about the experience of working in this industry. And as I said, it was informed by my mum's experience of working in a similar industry. And it was the first time, really, where I started to photograph people in a kind of in a more sort of pointed, subjective way. You know, I was deliberately looking for particular kinds of photographic expressions that might talk about some of the boredom and monotony of working in this sort of highly automated industry. And so this, you know, clocking in on a Monday morning, you know, I'm very deliberately making pictures when you get these sort of blank glazed expressions. So it's my feelings, my opinions coming through in the work much more strongly than would have previously been the case. Similarly with these images. And then the last image in the set would have been, you know, the that's the Monday morning clocking on, this is clocking off on a Friday afternoon. So, you know, the sort of antithesis of what that picture was like. And then the last section was really about the broader implications of new technology on all of us, and particularly in the vicinity of in which I was working in South Wales. Thing that struck me about working inside the factories was that all of the workstations were numbered, and so, you know, people were referred to as, you know, in relation to their workstation rather than as personalities. So that depersonalization of the workspace was really interesting, and I tried to emphasize that in this picture, which is the Miss AB Electronics Beauty Competition in the social club. And so, you know, I would deliberately objectify these women by, you know, chopping their heads off where the frame is placed, and making emphasis of the numbers, you know, to pick up on this idea here. And then this picture was made in the post office in Newport, and it's on what we used to call Gyro Day. I don't think it's called that anymore. You know, when you used to go and cash your dole check. And this was an advert that appeared on the screen quite briefly, and I'd seen it and thought, you know, I could factor that into a picture in some way. And so, you know, I'd start to work now in a kind of premeditated way, you know, recognize the potential for something, try and anticipate how a situation might grow into something different, and just simply wait and be patient for things to come to me rather than me sort of, you know, running around trying to capture things. I used to do a lot of fishing when I was a child, and I always use the analogy that, you know, fishing and photography for me are quite similar. You know, you sort of read the water, you know, you read the possibilities, you deliberately cast your line in a particular place, and you sit and you're patient and you wait for things to come to you. And that's pretty much my way of working. So that came out over a long period of time. Okay, we're going to go over in the corner now. Okay, so at this point, I'm out of college. I've done the Valleys project. I've become much more interested in the medium of photography as a medium in its own right, rather than, you know, what you might say with it. Obviously, I still want to say things with it, but much more interested in images, and became increasingly more and more interested in the possibilities of colour photography, and I was aware of Paul Graham, who had made his book, The A1, in, I think it came out in 82. Somebody might correct me on that. But also Martin Parr, who, you know, started to work on his Last Resort project. So I was aware of those two pieces of work in Britain. Also, people that never really get acknowledged in British colour photography would be people like Charlie Meacham, who, you know, was working in colour long before Martin. And Bob Phillips in Bristol, those kinds of people. However, there was a moment which was me attending a talk at Chapter Arts Centre in Cardiff, which was given by an American author called Sally O'Clair, and she had just published a book called New Colour, and it was a collection of American colour photography. And for me, it was the first time I'd seen the work of people like Eggleston, Stephen Shaw, Joel Mervitz, you know, people who now we might have more familiarity with as photographers. And it really made me think of the possibilities of colour. And it's really interesting because Anna Fox is here somewhere. Where are you, Anna? And you went—you had the same lecture in Farnham from Sally O'Clair, and it was a moment for you too. So it's a shared thing that, you know, happened totally independent of each other. And so I became much more interested in the use of colour. And I decided that the thing that I wanted to photograph was the thing that best represented the times for me. And this is, you know, early 80s. So it's sort of, you know, Thatcherism in ascendancy, really. You know, the free market economy, you know, the notions of individuality, you know, the culture of greed and singularity. Those are the kinds of things that were percolating around politically. And those are the kinds of things that I wanted to try and take on photographically as well. But I was really struck by the challenge of trying to photograph some of these things that might represent big ideas, but do them in really simple, ordinary places like shopping centres and supermarkets. And of course, you know, the retail landscape of Britain then is very different to how it is now. You know, this was just at the time where, you know, the idea of the shopping mall was being introduced, the out-of-town retail parks were being introduced, so it was a point where there was a real shift in where and how people shopped. And so the work marks that as well. It was also a point where I started to work on a larger format camera. Everything else had been done on 35mm up to this point. And that was important for me because it meant that I could make photographs where there could be small details in the pictures that could be read easily and understood. And so what that meant for me was there was less need to try and make those big, bold graphic visual statements. I could make pictures that were seemingly quieter in their intent, but as you looked closer, they might reveal themselves to you. So that was particularly interesting to me. And, you know, at the time, you know, never realised that this would become the case, but it was quite a significant moment in British documentary photography, this idea of a generation of people starting to work in colour. Seems absurd now because, you know, everybody, I teach photography and I don't have any students who work in black and white at all now. But at the time, you know, the norm for documentary practice, for serious documentary practice, the expectation was that you would work in black and white. So the idea of working in colour was quite a radical step, bizarrely. And it's amazing that today there's two other people here who were part of that same movement as well. Anna's here, Anna Fox, and Julian Germain over there. So it's nice for those guys to be here. And I'm sure they would testify to what I'm saying, that it was a provocation, you know, on our part, unintended, but nevertheless it was. So I try and make these pictures that, you know, talked about the idea of, you know, the nature of shopping, the kind of increasing Americanization of where and how we shopped. I've always maintained this idea that I photograph people, but I don't think my pictures are necessarily about people. I don't think they're necessarily about individuals. I'm definitely interested in the kind of systems in which people operate and are controlled, you know, whether they're controlled by consumerism or whatever. That's really the thing I'm interested in. But I express that through the photographing of people. So I'm not interested in trying to make pictures of people that ridicules them in any way. I'm much more interested in the wider kind of social landscape that they're in. And a picture like this would be a good example of that. How, you know, obviously my interest is in this kind of paradoxical notion we have about animals. You know, this idea that they're kind of cuddly creatures that, you know, get mythologized in children's books and things. And then, you know, the reality of how, you know, meat is marketed and consumed. So those are things I'm interested in. These are two pictures that never made the edit, and that's been an interesting process doing this project, is looking back at things and revisiting projects. You know, I'm probably guilty of editing far too quickly, And you know, when I went back, I found pictures that I hadn't previously considered. This was never in the original edit. And I particularly enjoy this picture now. There's elements of this that I can't believe I passed over. It's a sort of interesting, ambiguous moment. Like a sort of, you know, he's at the altar of consumerism. And there's two identical twins in the background. You know, there's just lots of things happening in the picture that's kind of weird. So I missed that. I do remember these two pictures, and I made them very deliberately. The other thing that was happening, apart from the consumer boom in the 80s, was also, you know, the issues that were around Greenham Common, you know, the sighting of US nuclear weapons in Britain, and all of the ways that that was contested. And I've tried to make references sort of obliquely to those kinds of issues. And so when you get time, you can look at this picture, Price of Freedom. But on the screen, there's a speech by Ronald Reagan, and there's a subtitle that's underneath, and it says something like, you know, I'm sorry, I tried and it failed. He was talking about the failed attempt to rescue the hostages in Iran. But accompanying that is a picture made in Bradford that's Marks and Spencer's, and the woman is buying a shirt, and on the shirt is the American Eagle emblem, and written across the top of it, it says freedom. So I like that idea of being able to try and take on, you know, bigger kind of political subjects, but in a simple place like, you know, Marks and Spencer's in Bradford. So I'm trying to articulate lots of different things. This picture obviously has a relationship to this idea of militarism, and it's a picture that, you know, when you're a photographer and you make photographs and, you know, your pictures go out into the outside world, you don't really have much control over them anymore. You know, they take on a life of their own. They have different experiences as they're in different exhibitions around, you know, or in various places. And this particular picture, that is very true, because it's made in Newport, in B&Q in Newport. And I lived and worked in Newport for a long time, but then I left and came back 7 years ago now to teach back at the course in Newport. And as I, my first year back in Newport coincided with the exhibition at the Tate, which was called How We Are, which was the Tate's first major photographic exhibition. And this picture was in the exhibition. And the local newspaper in Newport had got wind of this idea that this photograph had been made in Newport and it was going to be in this, you know, exhibition, and they phoned me to see whether I'd be interested in them reprinting the photograph with a view of trying to find some of the people that were in the picture. So remember, something like 25 years has elapsed, you know, from the point when this picture was made to the point that I'm talking about. Anyway, I said, yeah, I think that would be an interesting process, and so they did that. And they phoned me about a week later to say that they'd made contact with them. And he said, are you sat down? And I said, no, I'm not. No, do I need to be? He said, well, you might. It's an interesting story. He said, okay, we found them. He said, the dad went, children in, so I won't use the proper word. The dad went years ago, but we found the mother and the child. And the child, who is probably 5 years old in the photograph, was then at that time a serving soldier in Iraq. So it's interesting, you know, that this young child being subjected to this kind of wallpaper, you know, could it affect a child's psychology? I don't know, but it seems to suggest that particular story. So that's interesting, I think, what happens with your photographs and how they have this life beyond their initial use. Where did that book go? So. So I spent a lot of time photographing in shops, retail parks, garden centres. You know, these were all the kinds of places that people would now go to for social interaction. You know, there was a time where bank holidays you'd go off to the seaside or something, But, you know, this time people were going off to, you know, I don't know, Comic Warehouse or something, you know, for their bank holiday weekends. So it was interesting, that whole shift that was going on. The other thing that was happening was there was an encouragement for people to own their house for the first time, okay? And so there was a huge housing boom. Lots of these, you know, Barrett estates, Wimpy estates were being developed everywhere. And that interested me on the basis of, you know, the house being the kind of ultimate sort of consumer object, really. So I made a lot of photographs in and around these new housing estates. And something that isn't in the book, in the exhibition, are these images, which I'll leave the books, you won't see them at that distance, but I made a lot of photographs inside show homes on these estates, and I was really particularly interested in the show home, because at this time, Wimpy had, on the estate I photographed in, houses that represented five different economic bands, and they had a particular strategy in their show homes where they would deliberately leave things like half-read newspapers, unfinished knitting, you know, around in the room, so that when you went around the rooms, it felt somehow familiar. You know, you could associate and recognise something about the space. But they also had this strategy of having a basket of shopping on the kitchen table, and the contents of that basket would change depending on the economic, you know, value of the house. I thought that was really interesting. So it made me think about what are they actually presenting in these show homes, you know, and if everything has been so carefully considered, how might that mirror some of the kind of drivers of the culture that we were living in? So I started to sort of, you know, look at these homes much more closely. And this is in one of the show homes, and the title of the book that's here is called The New Economy. Okay, and I haven't placed that there, it's just, you know, pure chance, but it's interesting that it relates in that way to the times. This picture is in the same house, and it's the boys' bedroom, and it's intended to be seen that way because there's a sign on the door that says boys' room. And it seems interesting to me that, you know, in the minds of the designer, you know, the boy was expected to be the successful kind of competitive member of the family. You know, there was various clues like trophies. There's a diary there, so he's going to be sort of organised and in demand. There's books. He's going to be a scholar, you know. And his sister's room, which was right next door, is really all about image. You know, it's pink, it's fluffy, it's full of dolls and cutesy things. So I think that's, you know, an interesting representation of an aspect of culture as well. Again, you know, trying to deal with something as complicated as kind of gender politics through something as ordinary and as simple as a show home. So those are the kinds of challenges that I'm interested in. What? And then we're going to go down here. So this is the piece of work that became the project Flogging a Dead Horse. And obviously we've put this here because it has a relationship to this work, you know, whereas, you know, this is actual real life coal mining. This is a kind of representation of what it used to look like. It's an idealized kind of representation of that industry. And, you know, all of that has been reduced down to these sort of, you know, objects that are sort of for sale on this stand in a shopping mall. It's made in the Metro Centre in Gateshead, which at the time of making was the biggest shopping mall, I believe, in Europe, and it sat right on what used to be the heart of the North East Coalfield. So it's that sort of, you know, the idea of that post-industrial world really became the subject for all of this work. But again, it's biographical, you know, because it's about how these places represent working people, how they represent that kind of, you know, working experience, and it's about the way that experience has been, through heritage culture, has been sort of purified and sanitized and Disneyfied, you know, and it's turned into entertainment. So that's really my kind of issue with it. The opening picture is the one for the project, is the one that that's on the wall over there, the man with the movie camera. You can look at that later. But that's made in a place called Beamish, calls itself the Northern Experience. And so that's part of the interest as well, is how, you know, not only working class people, but particularly Northern working class people have been represented through a heritage culture. You know, the kind of predominance of the flat cap, you know, in these kinds of pictures are all parts of the things I'm interested in. We're going this way. But the work also tried not to dwell too much on industrial history. I tried to widen it a little bit and look at a wider sense of heritage culture. And so I'd spend a lot of time photographing in places that weren't necessarily having this strong relationship to former heavy industry. I made pictures in more established heritage places, like this is in the Tower of London, and this is at the, I think it's the Royalty and Empire Museum in Windsor. So I like this idea, this kind of notion of colonialism, and the idea that a young black man would want to wear a Union Jack, you know, to celebrate those kind of colonial histories. It sort of seems paradoxical to me. So I'm kind of fascinated by that. And the idea of, you know, the man with the bowler hat, you know, being the kind of quintessential English imperialist, you know, with his spear. So those are sort of little visual analogies I'm trying to tease out. I also photographed a lot in places. There used to be a time, wasn't there, where we used to define areas of Britain by what they made. You know, Sheffield was steel, Bradford was wool, Manchester was cotton, South Wales was coal, etc. And, you know, now that all of that industry has gone into decline, a lot of regions really had and have struggled to rebrand themselves. And some of the regions adopted this idea of a kind of cultural landscape. And so, you know, I noticed, you know, driving up the motorway, you'd see signs that would say, you know, welcome to Shakespeare country, or welcome to Dickens country, you know. So there was this kind of cultural landscape, cultural map now of Britain. And so I decided to look at that as well as a part of a manifestation of heritage culture. So this is in John Constable country, where you were taken on a guided tour of some of the sites that Constable painted, and you could compare as they were then to how they are now. And this is Dickens country in Rochester in Kent. And it's an event organized by the local council. It's a Dickensian Christmas, where every year the council hires this snowmaking machine to drive up and down the high street and covers everywhere in snow to create this sort of, you know, Dickensian feel. So what I haven't said is that shortly after I'd finished making the I Can Help pictures, up to that point, I was working as a technician on the photography course at Newport. And I left and I entered the precarious world of freelance photography. And in many ways, it's something I'd been trained for, because Newport was really all about, I mean, at that time it was, you know, David Hearn was the captain, you know, and it was very much the magnum ethos of producing people who would, you know, work in the industry of photojournalism. So I sort of had all the training, but I'd sort of avoided it, probably more out of cowardice than anything else. Anyway, I left because the exhibition was on in London, and I'd had some inquiries from magazines asking if I'd be interested in doing assignments for them. And so I decided that I would try that. I've always been really pragmatic about my photography, and I know some people in the world of photography don't like me for this, but I've always had the need to try and, you know, make a living out of making pictures, and that has meant that sometimes I've had to do things that, you know, may run contrary to some of the interests that I've expressed in other projects. But I've always really quite liked the challenge of pushing out what I call this kind of documentary look into the commercial world. And so, you know, when I had inquiries from people like the Sunday Times magazine, some of the spreads are in the vitrines behind me, you know, I willingly embraced that because I saw it as an opportunity to try and interject, you know, some different kinds of picture making into those magazines. And at the end of this project, I was contacted by an advertising agency to see if I'd be interested in working on an advertising campaign for Volkswagen cars. And, you know, that was quite a difficult phone call for me to take because I'd done all this work about consumerism, you know, and now here I am speaking to an ad agency. You know, do I want to work in advertising? And, you know, the sensible, arguably, thing would have been to have said no, thank you, and kept the purity and of my integrity. But, you know, again, I needed to make a living. But I also really interested in that challenge, you know, of putting a different kind of picture making into what was then a fairly boring kind of world of advertising photography. And so I said yes, and I did the job, and it had absolutely nothing to do with me really, but it was more about the idea. It won a gold DNAD award, a gold pencil, which is like the holy grail of advertising. And I honestly had no idea what that meant at that time. But of course what it meant was that lots of people then came and wanted to, because advertising's terrible, it's very parasitic, you know, and it's very underconfident, you know. If somebody's won something or been successful, it's like that's the go-to person, you know, we want some of that glory. And and so I started getting inquiries to the point where I couldn't manage them, so I knew nothing about the industry. So then I got an agent, a commercial agent, and then I'm in really deep, you know, because I've now got a commercial agent. His interest is to find me as much work as he possibly can because, you know, he makes 25% off of everything that I do. And that's how I got drawn into the advertising world. I have to say I really thoroughly enjoyed it because what I found amazing about working in advertising was that everything was in service of the picture, you know. Where previously, you know, I had to go through endless negotiations to get access to supermarkets or, you know, wherever, or other people's lives in order to make photographs. In the commercial world, you know, it was just so easy. You could get anything you wanted, and it was like being a kid in a sweet shop. You know, you could come up with all these mad ideas, or I'll have that, you know, I'll have 10 of those, and then, yeah, of course we can make that happen for you. And I want a rain machine as well, you know, okay. You know, and it just became bonkers, really. To the point where I kind of lost sight a little bit, I suppose, about what it was that really interested me in the first instance about photography. I lost a sense of what motivated me, what constituted, you know, good photography. I was really busy commercially because, you know, if you're not making photographs, then you're at meetings talking about making photographs, or, you know, you're out scouting locations, or you're in some casting studio looking at people that are going to populate the pictures. And so I had absolutely no time left to make work for myself. More importantly, I had no time left to actually be involved in the world of photography that I started in. And I sort of disappeared. You know, I wasn't at openings anymore. I didn't go to festivals anymore. I felt completely at sea and a little bit lost because of that. And then Patrick Sutherland, a good friend of mine, rang me completely out of the blue. He teaches at the London College of Communication. And he said, we're thinking of starting this project in the Elephant and Castle because it's an area that's going to be regenerated. And it's a 10-year regeneration program. We want to commission a different photographer every year to photograph a different aspect of the regeneration. Would you be interested in doing it, the first one? And I thought, God, you know, it was scary, actually. It's interesting because I used to be scared of those phone calls from picture editors and art buyers, you know, I can't do that. And I'd gone in complete reverse then, where the kinds of people I felt comfortable, I felt intimidated by them. Anyway, I said, yes, I'll do it, because I saw it as an opportunity of getting back to something that I used to do. Just before we keep that in your heads, because we're going to go off there in a minute, but just before we do, I forgot to say something. There's some pictures on the wall behind over there, which are pictures that I still enjoy, and I think are sort of successful as individual pictures, but they're all things that have come out of commercial assignments that I've never really, with the exception of the one on the extreme left, which is in the Flogging a Dead Horse book, I've never really been able to place any of those pictures because I'm so used to working on projects, you know, specific things. And those are pictures that have popped up out of, you know, advertising or magazine assignments that I still like, but I've never really had a home for. So I've never shown those before. This is the first time I've publicly shown those pictures before, but that's where they come from. So let's go back over in the corner. Sorry,
Anne. It's all right. So long as it's not squint.
So, I was involved in the commercial world of photography. I'd sort of lost sight of my original motivations for making pictures, lost my subject, lost my kind of, you know, cultural references, but wanted to try and get back, and I made a few false starts. I thought I'd make a project that drew on some of the skills that I'd learned through working in advertising, you know, skills to do with lighting and, you know, working with models, and I embarked on a series of constructed pictures, that being one of them, and this being another. I'll pin it up later. But there were, you know, so these are all staged, they're all set up, they're all, you know, drawing on those kind of skills that I'd acquired through the commercial world. But never really felt completely satisfied with them. So that's part of me sort of fishing around and trying to get back. And then the phone call from Patrick Sutherland about the Elephant and Castle. So it was this regeneration project, and you know, the Elephant Castle, as a lot of you will know, is you know, a region of London that's very historic and very important. It's got a big, strong working class community, very historic in that sense. It's also very diverse, you know, culturally, ethnically. One of the first places that, you know, migrants go to when they come to London and settle, and so it's got this rich, diverse history. It also the commission, and so the plan was to pull down all of these tower blocks, all these places where people lived, and build luxury apartments, because it's actually it's not that far from the city of London. So in terms of a piece of real estate, it's really, you know, strategically well placed, and therefore very valuable, and so all these people who, you know, had lived happy lives and, you know, generations of families were being subjected to this change, and that really interested me because it coincided with my parents. The house that I was born in, the one in Buttershaw, was demolished in order to make way for a private housing estate, and so, you know, I had witnessed and felt some of the anxieties that my parents felt being subjected to that, and it wasn't dissimilar from what some of the people I photographed were going through. So it was a sort of, it was a timely piece of work for me to do, really. And I think I found my feet again, you know, I found my way back into making pictures, the kinds of which I enjoyed. And one of the things I deliberately wanted to just make photographs on the street. I didn't want to, you know, I wanted a quiet life. I didn't want to have to go through endless negotiations with people. So I just wanted to go and make photographs of things that I came across on the streets. I was very deliberately looking for some kinds of expressions of, you know, anxiety to kind of connect with how people might be feeling about being displaced. But whilst I was there, and times when I wasn't making pictures, I used to go around the outdoor market that's at the Elephant and Castle. And there's a Rastafarian guy there who sells all these sort of herbal remedies. And he was selling these pots of incense that about this big in real life. And they have all these titles, you know, breakup, money drawing, court case. And I thought they were really interesting things to use in the work because it was a way of suggesting some of the kind of, you know, social problems that existed there without actually explicitly taking it on in the photographs. So that's why those were integrated into the work. And I forgot to mention my house print that I deliberately brought all the way from South Wales in my house. This is a Bradford Corporation brick, and it's the only thing I have left of the house I was born in. So this was my house. That's it.
Paul, that was really wonderful, informative, and very moving and personal. Thank you. You're going to take questions now?
If there are any.
Yeah, if there's any questions of people. Oh, phew. I know what, I'll pick it up.
Okay.
If you want to sit down, we can have about a 10-minute question and answer.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. There was a question here.
Yeah, what was your decision stuck when you've chosen to use flash photography? Was it A, technical limitation of the film at the time, or more because of the visual aesthetic?
It's both, if I'm honest. Both, yeah.
And your use of flash has changed on these.
Yeah.
It's clearly away from the camera.
Correct.
And
yeah.
What led you to that decision?
Okay, well, I started using flash at the time when I started to work with a larger format camera. It's a technical thing, isn't it? You know, but because it's a larger format, then the depth of focus is much smaller. So in order to work with a smaller aperture to get more depth of focus, I needed to put more light into the picture, so hence the flash. But of course, I'm also aware of the aesthetic kind of implications of that as well,
yeah.
And the way that it makes the photographs look. So I was enjoying both of those elements, really. In this project, you're right, there is flash in the picture, but it's off camera.
Mm-hmm.
So this is me working with my very good friend Marcus, who assisted me with all the commercial things. And he's got a light on a sound boom, you know, off camera. So that's how that's working. Watches me, and he'll follow where I am, or I might tell him, you know, that. So here I would just stand and photograph everybody that came past, and so, you know, he would be, have the light positioned in such a way that he knows where I'm focusing, because we've had that conversation, and so it's sort of premeditated in that.
Paul, you can certainly take pictures, but you can't hang them.
That's what we're here for.
Paul, can you say something about your process of actually being invisible to the people in the photographs? Because you've got something quite interesting about how you position yourself in relation to your subject so that they all look completely oblivious to the fact that they're in the photograph.
I can't remember what I said now. I think the thing is, if you photograph people a lot, then you develop an ability to be able to read people. And read body language, and you also develop a sense of when people don't want to be photographed, and I always respect that. You know, I never go beyond if I feel that, you know, just instinctively, intuitively, if I know that people don't want to be photographed, I'll always respect that. But partly what I do as well is I'm really honest about the way I make pictures, and it's very obvious that I'm a photographer. You know, I use a big camera and I use a big flash gun, and I don't hide that fact. So, you know, I'm not surreptitiously pulling the camera out from under my coat and stealing these pictures. And so I think people just get used to me being around. But also because I quite often will position myself in relation to what might happen, I kind of just dissolve, you know, because I'm there all the time. Like the picture in the post office, you know, I was there for, you know, 8 hours. The picture in the B&Q store there, you know, I saw that wallpaper and I knew that there was a picture opportunity there at some point. And I went back to B&Q, to that aisle, for days and days and days. And I would only photograph in that aisle, waiting, you know, for something to happen. And my patience were rewarded, because obviously I could have never predicted, you know, the camouflage trousers and everything.
Thomas Street tells a story about how he was commissioned to photograph in the Metropolitan Museum in New York.
In where?
The Metropolitan Museum in New York. And he waited for days and days and days. And then he gave up and hired 200 extras.
No. God, lazy.
In an anonymous place such as London, rather than a more friendly place, which I imagine the Welsh Valleys to be, are you more, are you less invisible in somewhere like that?
It's interestingly different, I think. You know, I mean, photographing in London, but I think I'm always reluctant to make these comparisons between London and everywhere else. You know, but I think it is true to say that possibly people living in London are more sensitive about photography. Perhaps more aware about, you know, how photography might work and how it might represent them. So I found it harder there than anywhere else. But also, you know, the way that I make pictures, I don't necessarily have a set way of doing things. You know, sometimes I talk to people a lot. Sometimes I might have a conversation and follow somebody around the supermarket as they're shopping, making pictures. Other times I might just grab something because it happens instantaneously, like the picture there of the baby with the meat. You know, that's just something that happened, and I made the picture. So it's a variety of different responses, really. But here, it was very much about not engaging with anybody, because that's kind of what I wanted, really. And I've never had any trouble photographing people, ever, you know, and honestly I haven't, and I know people that do, and a lot of my students, you know, always get grief when they try and photograph people that they don't know, and I've never had that, and I don't really truly know why that is, but I think it is something to do with just being open to the fact that you're making photographs, and confidence as well. I think that's important. You know, if you're slightly nervous and slightly shy, I think that shows in your body language, really. So I'm not aggressive, you know, and I'm respectful of people's space. But at the same time, I don't know, I just feel confident doing it, and maybe that makes that process easier.
You tend to work on your own, because I mean, I've sometimes seen packs of, well, you know, two or three photographers, you know, as a little gang photographing,
yeah.
And that's obviously a lot more intimidating than just one person.
Yeah, no, I mean, I worked with an assistant here, but I'm completely on my own with everything else, yeah, completely, purposely. So, apart from, you know, the advertising things where, you know, you've got a team of people around you.
I'm just thinking about the shift of context you've gone from. At one time, there was a kind of clear group of documentary photography practice that you were part of, and was part of Newport's, and still is to some extent, and then shifting within the commercial advertising sphere, your references change and who you're bouncing off and the way you're making, understanding the pictures you're making. Now, have you shifted into the new context, which is the contemporary fine art realm? And this is quite a contentious issue.
You mean documentary in the fine art world?
It's where we are now, is that, you know, art photographers are are artists.
Yeah.
Before you went into advertising, photographers were in the documentary realm. So I'm just wondering, because it strikes me this, when we're making pictures, we're looking within that context with which we exist. You look across those parallels of fine art practitioners now, rather than this group of people who were documentary photographers or who were straight photographers.
If I understand you right, are you saying, do I think photographers are now self-consciously making work that would fit the fine art world?
More pointedly, how are you aware of that context of being within this fine art world?
Okay, I mean, I do have a gallery. I don't sell anything. but I do. And I have exhibited work, but it's a part of what I do, but it's not the sum total of what I do. So in terms of, elements of professionalism, the way you might present work, the way you might change how you talk about work to different clients, that's an acknowledgement on my part of the different ways that one has to negotiate with those different worlds. So yeah, the language changes sometimes, but I don't think the work has changed radically. I think even the advertising stuff that I do has some kind of semblance of, what I do for myself. And arguably that's the thing that made me attractive to that commercial world, is the ability to do that on demand, So I don't think visually it changes radically, but how you frame work definitely changes in relation to who you're talking to. I talk about the same piece of work differently to a magazine editor than I would to a curator, because they are different worlds and they've got different, expectations.
You talked a lot about representation, and sort of in this world, you've got like something saying court case next to that guy, so it's sort of your representation of him. I mean, he could be he doesn't sort of have a voice, does he? It's about what you're saying.
No, it isn't, but that's your interpretation of it as well and not mine. Because, I'm not saying that that's the association.
It never occurred
there
to me to associate the pictures that's which punctuate with anything on either side of them.
I mean, the shift in scale of those is an attempt to avoid that, firstly.
So what sort of your meaning about that?
Well, it's up to you. I don't have one necessarily.
You must have had in photographing that object and putting it there. There must be some.
Okay, well, I've exhibited this work before, and last time, this picture wasn't with that picture. So it's the only one instance where there is a specific relationship between the incense pots and the photograph is this one here. That Bible incense with that photograph there. And that's really because, I like the kind of religious connotations in that photograph. I like the fact that that young man with long hair is sort of Christ-like. I like the fact that they're all reaching up. That's the only time that I'm really consciously putting those together. But previously, those associations have been quite random.
What are they reaching for?
Ah, look at the picture and see if you can work out. Look.
I don't even know if I want to answer that, because I always say to my students that when you're making photographs, what you don't show is arguably more important than actually what you do show, because when you're a photographer, you're actually extracting something from the real world, aren't you? And that thing that you extract has a kind of life that's independent of all the circumstances that surrounded the reality, in the way that I talked about that picture of the white man. You can only experience that photograph, that situation, through looking at that picture, because the reality was very different. I think the same is true of this picture here, because I know what's happening. And actually what's really happening is quite mundane in relation to what the possibilities of the picture might be. So if I will tell you, but it sort of destroys it a little bit.
Let them all have a look and see if they can.
Well, they can't see it, can they?
Can you guys speak?
Huh?
You can work it out if you look at it
first. Can you?
That's what I'm saying. Get them to.
Go on then, what is it?
Some kind of sweets that are being thrown, like crisps.
Yeah, there's
some packets or something.
Yeah, it was a spontaneous promotion from a crisp company. So behind me is a woman on top of a stepladder throwing out packets of crisps, and that's what they're all reaching for. So it's quite mundane. But
we'll take a couple of more questions and then we need to wind it up.
Okay.
That's okay, yeah.
You called the sequence from a distance.
Yeah.
But when I came to look at the exhibition a couple of weeks back, these particular pictures kind of leapt out at me more than the others. I really enjoy the other pictures. But it's because they each have a very central emphasis to the composition, and there's usually a character right in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm still curious about the dramatization of these images versus your other ones. Mm-hmm. And I love them and I'm very drawn to them, but I don't quite understand the idea from a distance.
The title?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, you're right about the central figure and you're right about the dramatization of that. There is always a central figure because there's a central pool of light, you know, because the light's on a stick and it casts, you know, a certain circumference of light. So the only person that's going to be exposed correctly will be the person that's in that light. So that tells you why there's a central figure all the time. The title really is about, is that the text, there's a text went with it by written by Giles Fraser, who writes for The Guardian. And he uses that phrase, from a distance, in the text. And I liked it because for me, it's simultaneously about the physical distance that people that live in the elephant have traveled to be there, you know, because there's a huge, diverse, you know, ethnic mix of people. It's also about the distance that I am from them and their experience, because, you know, I'm a nice middle-class boy now, and so it's about that difference too. So it's meant to be sort of open in that way.
Your picture of the wallpaper,
yeah,
and getting and having been made in contact. Were you made actually in contact with the people?
I spoke to the mum on the phone.
Mm.
Yeah.
And so, did you get any sense of the picture having affected the people in it? Not.
If I'm honest, they were actually oblivious about the existence of the photograph. Okay, they had no memory of me making the picture. But I spoke to her on the phone, and I sent her two copies of the book. One of which she sent out to her son in Iraq. So there's an awareness of it now, but at the time there wasn't.
And the sales assistant behind the woman, any connection with her? There was a sales assistant
no,
there?
No.
Talking about the ambiguity of the image, could you be showing it to somebody to say, look how awful this wallpaper is? This is putting up on the kid's wall.
Yeah, I mean, because, you know, there are stories, aren't there? I mean, you photographer, you know that when you make pictures, you know, there's things happening all around you that have got some kind of relationship to, you know, what results in the final picture, that actually somebody who views that final picture has got no sense of at all. So there are people stood behind me that they're with, and he's showing that to them, but of course they don't factor it into the picture. I don't think it's...
But the picture doesn't suggest whether he likes it.
No. No,
I think it's the cigarette in the corner of the mouth that makes it for me.
Yeah.
It's just, I don't know what it is, but something about it really makes the shot, obviously, the wallpaper and the trousers as well.
Yeah.
But you do end up kind of judging that person.
Yeah.
You know, that individual does come over being represented in a certain way. People are bound to make assumptions about it.
Well, I'm not making that judgment.
Maybe that's what you're saying, though, saying why judge it?
Yeah,
in that sense.
So that's an argument for you guys to have. It's not, for me.
But you know, when you put pictures on the wall, that those questions are being raised. That's what you do. You can't say that you put those pictures on the wall.
Yeah, but I'm not. I'm not encouraging. The purpose of that picture is not to encourage people to think how stupid he might be. It's about the role of that wallpaper in that child's life. That's really what the picture's about for me. But of course, there are all these other different readings, aren't there? And that, you know, it's a moral minefield, isn't it, when you photograph people and you represent them in galleries or books or whatever.
It might have been his bedroom for his bachelor's pad.
Well, it wasn't, because the mum told me on the phone that kid had that wallpaper on his wall for years. So
now we have.
Working on a project at the moment, or have you got some working?
you know what, I'm not, and I actually think I've given up photography. Seriously, I think I have.
To do what?
Well, I teach full time. I teach photography. I'm still really passionate about the subject, and I'm aware of everything that's happened in the contemporary world of photography, and I'm involved in it. But if I said to you that I still make photographs, I'd be lying, because I don't really. I don't have the time. You know, I work full time. And that often means I'm actually working over weekends as well, so I don't really have the time to make work. But I also, it's professional suicide, isn't it? I don't think I've got anything else to say. You know, I just don't think I've got anything else to say. You know, I've got all this stuff out of my system, and I don't really have anything that I really feel strongly about that I want to photograph.
So what happens when the next commission comes along and the university offers you a sabbatical?
Well, there won't be a commission though, because I'm not. I'm just don't have. I'm invisible. I don't have a website.
You got run up for this one.
Yeah, that was a while ago.
Yeah. It will happen.
I don't know if it will. I probably won't do it, Anna. Honestly, I won't.
But the next thing, which leads into to my announcements, the next thing you're working on is trying to get this body of work published as a book.
I was just thinking about that because, first of all, the hour was an amazing tour of photography, you know, and the way that you motivated everything was just incredible. But also, I think you've got nothing else to say because that's our history, isn't it?
Yeah.
And we're going through it all again. Recession is here, and so we're going through it again.
Mm.
And so I was thinking, I was thinking of a question about text and pictures. But anyway, I'm dying to get hold of the book.
So can I just talk about the book just now? Because on that bombshell, this makes my announcement even better. So Paul's trying to raise the funding himself to get his book published in the middle of this year. And we're trying to help him out. And we're selling unlimited edition original prints by Paul for a minimum donation of £20. And all the money will go towards publishing the book, which will take on board all this work. So we're selling them at the front desk. Unfortunately, because it went so well when we put out the first call, we've only got 7 at the moment, but as the thinking behind them, because this is the 7 in my hand.
Signed and stamped on the reverse.
I'm just getting to that. We will take your name and address and we'll produce more. And they are signed by Paul and stamped to sort of say, verify it's from here. So I think it's
good
really good cause. And I've got one more announcement, which is to do with...
I think Pippa had her hand up, did you?
Oh, it's okay, I was going to... Well, actually, it was kind of following on from the gentleman over there. I was thinking about your sense of history, because it strikes me, being in this room with all of, all of these bodies of work here, it's such an incredible archive of British society and culture over those 3 decades. And I wondered about that sense of historical consciousness. Were you aware when you started making this work that that's what you would be doing, or did that emerge as your practice went on?
I mean, not consciously aware of doing that, leaving that, but I was definitely driven by, the subject in relation to its reflection of times lived at the time that the work was made. So that's in my head, definitely, the pertinence of consumerism or heritage culture at those particular times, were for me some of the key issues that were happening, not just in photography, but, socially, politically, culturally. So I'm conscious of that. But, I didn't deliberately set out to map, 3 decades of British life, but in some sort of way, I recognise that, I've done that in some small way. But I've also, for me, what's interesting is I've mapped my own biography as well.
Mm-hmm.
I can see the changes that I've gone through as a person as well in relation to the work that I've made. That's probably hidden to most people, but I get it. And also, the changes that the working class people have gone through as well, through this process. Is also part of it, and that's why it's really pertinent that, and interesting that I've had the show here, that it opened here, because it's really fitting in that sense.
It's an incredible achievement.
Thank you.
To make money for impression.
You
get
around the hat.
No, we at our last talk, Melanie Friends, and we're really, really committed to that. You know, our photographers and artist talks are free, but times are hard. So when some of you have noticed when you registered on an Eventbrite, we're asking if you can afford it or if you wanted to make a small donation. And we ask people when they booked for Paul's talk, if they make a small donation, their name will go into a hat and they can win one of those prints that we've been selling. So. Some people were generous, and the winner of the print is Matt Smith.